Hello and welcome to a very special midweek episode of the show. Yes, you lucky people, you get me twice in 1 week. Can't say that too often, it has to be said. Well, I have a day off today, so I thought, well, I'll indulge myself in a bit of whiskey tasting. Why not? And obviously, I'm indulging you guys as well. And obviously, as I mentioned last week, doing the Bunhaven episode of the show, that the samples came from the World Whiskey Awards of 2019. So I thought, well, let's do the Ardbeg one. So as you can see, 7 Ardbeg samples to work my way through. So I shall keep the waffle pretty short, because otherwise it's going to be a bit of a marathon episode of the show, it has to be said, even without me waffling away for a little bit. But anyway, no need to say very much about Ardbeg themselves that hasn't been said before, and I've done a couple of episodes of the show on Ardbeg, so let's just have a look at the lineup then, shall we? Life's misplaced revenge comes. Right, okay, so we're going to kick off with the 10-year-old, bottle of 46%. Aged, as far as I'm aware, entirely in American oak, and probably, in my personal opinion, the most improved 10-year-old over the last 20-odd years, I would say. Obviously, after Glenmorangie purchased the distillery in 1997 and embarked upon spending some money on it and investing in sort of casks, basically, the 10-year-old, I think, is just gone from strength to strength. I mean, Ardbeg itself was always renowned for sort of producing great quality spirit. It was just sort of like, you know, in the late 80s, early 90s, I think they were just reusing too many casks, and the casks were tired, and so were the bottlings. I mean, the amount of people that raved about the old 17-year-old was always beyond me, because I really didn't think it was a particularly great bottling. I mean, maybe with hindsight, if I've tasted it now, I might think differently of it, but certainly sort of way back then, about 20-odd years ago, and I'm not spending stupid money to get hold of a bottle just to check out whether it's still relatively piss poor. Second bottle we're going to be looking at is the Ardbeg Corryvreckan, bottled at 57.1. Now, I remember when this was first released back in 2003, it was, as the name suggested, a real whirlpool of intensity. And as far as I can remember, it was always aged, or it was a vatting, should we say, of spirit that had been aged in ex-American oak. And I think, having tasted it several times over the intervening 20-odd years, that they now actually use a little bit of sherry in it. Not a great deal. I mean, if you look at this one, which is the Uigeadail, and the Corryvreckan, the colour is very, very similar. And although I can find absolutely no mention whatsoever, and I have no direct dealings with the distillery, so I couldn't corroborate the fact, I think that there is some sherry in there, but we shall find out. Anyway, third bottling we'll be tasting is, like I said, the Uigeadail, bottled at 54.2. Now, this is definitely a vatting of both ex-bourbon and ex-sherry casks or butts, and was first released in 2008. Incidentally, you might think it's a bit of a funny way around of doing it. I'm kind of trying, again, doing it in hopefully stylistical order, or certainly the order I would think would be the best way of tasting them. Next bottling we'll be looking at is the first new addition to the core range. Well, I say new, I think it was 2017 when they released it, and it's a bottling called An Oa. Bottle of 46.6%, aged in a combination of ex-American oak and ex-Pedro Ximenez casks, and then married in ex-French oak. So, I mean, again, looking at the colour, I mean, it is quite light. I mean, you know, you would have thought Pedro Ximenez casks would give that a real darkness, but it's actually, in fairness, quite lighter than the Uigeadail. So it will be interesting to see how much Pedro Ximenez character there is in that particular bottling. Then we're going to move on to these two. This is the Ardbeg Grooves. It was the 2018 Ardbeg Day release. and a bottle of 46%, aged in heavily charred ex-red wine cask, which I assume means they were recharred by the distillery, and grooves is obviously to do with the fact that when you heavily char, you get these grooves in the wood. The second to last bottling we're looking at is the committee release version, which was bottled at 51.6%, and I'm guessing exactly the same casks we used to mature it, otherwise it would be a bit daft calling it the same thing, wouldn't it, really? I mean, you know, as much as I have bought previous committee releases, these days I just can't be bothered. I mean, I'm not going to sit at the computer at, you know, 5 minutes to midnight on release day in the hope that I can actually get hold of one, and the chances are probably not. At 5 minutes to midnight, I've got better things to be doing with my time, it has to be said, than sitting at a computer. And so, you know, I think this whole Ardbeg committee thing is just, you know, I've given up on it personally. But anyway, that's an aside. And the last bottling we'll be looking at is the Ardbeg Twenty Something. It's a 23-year-old. Was bottled at 46.3%. Again, a combination of ex Bourbon and ex Oloroso. Released sometime late 2017. And if you want to buy a bottle now, you're going to have to part with around about £600. Is it worth it? We shall find out. Anyway. So that's today's lineup. It's going to be quite an interesting one, and I might be a little bit tipsy by the end of it, but, you know, hell, let's give it a go. Right, okay, so let's kick off with the 10-year-old. Let's see what the nose gives us on this end, shall we? Lightly oily, briny, richly fruited, sort of quite dense apricot, touch of apple, some lovely dusty woody peat, and I think that's one of the things that I think has set Ardbeg apart from some of the other distilleries, is that it has, well, I suppose you could say all of the Islay distilleries have a distinct peating character, and I've always found Ardbeg to be more at the woodier end of the peating spectrum. And that's a lovely nose. I mean, that really is everything you would want from an Islay whiskey. It's got depth, it's got fruit, oiliness, slight tar, fish, peat, you know. I mean, what is not to like? Well, assuming you like peated whiskies, of course. What isn't there to like about this? And it's really clean. There's no manky old oak. It is absolutely pristine. I mean, in saying that, the oak doesn't give it a sort of an overt sort of vanilla-y kind of character. It's more giving it sort of like the structure. And there's a, you know, you sniff hard enough, you can just about make out the sort of the tannins beneath the peat. It's, yeah, it's heavier peated than Ardbeg pre Glenmorangie, but it's certainly not a monster by any stretch of the imagination. Anyway, let's see what the power's like. Chewy, malty, earthy peat, woody peat, rich, apricot, rounded, slightly oily, lovely mouthfeel. Slight mintiness kind of just right on the end. And it's got a lovely saline freshness, but again, it's all really harmonious. It's all really balanced. Lovely progression, getting an almost kind of green fruit on the very end, that sort of tart, almost sort of acidic green fruit. And it is a lovely mouthful, it has to be said. And like I said, I think this is probably, if not the best, certainly up there with maybe sort of Springbank 10-year-old as the most improved 10-year-old malt whiskey that you can actually get your hands on. And, you know, lovely. I thought I heard you calling me. Right, okay, so let's move on to the Corryvreckan. Let's see what the nose gives us on this end, shall we? Now, I'm convinced there is some sherry at work here. It is just too rich and too much dried fruit for there not to be. I mean, I remember when it was kind of a real maelstrom of American oak and peat and smoke. It's a little blunted now, I would say. It's a little bit less mad. It's kind of, you know, a little bit mellow. There's some lovely younger peaty notes, a little bit more earthy peat with a little medicinal kind of character. Not a great deal, a little. Again, it's got that sort of trademark rich, oily, full, dense character, but it's more salt, more intensity than on the 10-year-old, obviously from using younger spirit. But I think that there is definitely some sherry at work here. I mean, it has that slight sort of dried fruit, sweet sherriness kind of character going on, and it certainly doesn't have the direct crispness of what it used to have. That's not to say that it's better or worse than what it used to be. I just think it's just different now. And I personally prefer how it used to be, it has to be said. Anyway, let's see what the palate's like. Lovely intensity on the finish, lovely saltiness. And on the palate, I am convinced there is some sherry at work there. It's rich, it's quite treacly, there's a bit of tar, dusty peat. Almost a slight violetiness, which I don't often tend to get in Ardbeg, it has to be said. And it's not a sort of overt Bomori kind of violetiness, it's just a sort of a little bit there. A lovely tongue-tingling finish, real intensity. It's, like I said, I don't think it's the Corryvreckan of old. It is a little bit blunted now. It's kind of, maybe somebody's pulled the plug on the whirlpool and it's I don't know. You know, it isn't what it was, but it isn't bad, is what I'm trying to say. It's still got that sort of salty intensity. Obviously the higher ABV is helping that, but either way, that's still a very, very good whiskey. Right, moving on to the Uigeadail. Now, I mean, so many people love this bottling. I mean, it gets lauded as probably the best bottling in the core range, and let's take a look, let's see what the nose gives. There's a lot more oak. I'm getting toffee, I'm getting caramel, I'm getting slightly sort of darker treacle, slightly gritty Oloroso, but also slightly polished Oloroso as well. Where last week when I was looking at Bunnahabhain, it was a very Macallan-esque polished sherry character. This kind of has an element of that, but it's also got a sort of slightly rougher element as well, which is really quite nice. Less spirit character per se. I mean, there is a little bit of barley, there is a little bit of dense apricot, but it's more about the oak, it's more about the toffee, the Oloroso, slightly tarry peat, salt. I mean, it is a stunning nose, it has to be said. Whether I would go as far as saying it's better than the 10-year-old, it's a subjective point. I love the purity of the 10-year-old, is what I like. But, you know, this has got so much going for it. It is really a very, very impressive nose. Anyway, let's see what the palate's like. It's a gritty, chewy peat dust, wood spice, charry, leathery, slightly tobacco-y finish. I mean, that is an intense mouthful. The ABV obviously helps that intensity. Lovely saltiness, lovely sweet peat note on the aftertaste. Certainly the Oloroso is a lot more noticeable on the palate. It's a lot more upfront, so you're getting a lot more of the sort of darker dried fruits, the raisinated fruits, the treacle, the tar. But that finish just lingers and lingers. I mean, it's a stunning whiskey. I mean, you know, 50 something odd pounds maybe, I guess, or mid 50s. You know, it's creeping up. But I still think it's a stunningly good whiskey. And the aftertaste is just stunning. And see the lights between the dust. Right, let's move on to the An Oa. Let's see what the nose gives us in this end, shall we? You know, that's almost delicate. I mean, in comparison to just tasting the Uigeadail, yes, I'm getting some dried grapey notes, and there's a touch of gritty tannin. The peat is not quite so intense, which is probably more down to the cask, but it's got a real mellow character, it has to be said. It's not a sort of in-your-face kind of PX monster. So I'm guessing that the amount of PX casks that they use must be relatively low. Again, it's got a lovely crispness, it's got the weight, it's got the oiliness, it's got the saltiness. The peat does seem a little subdued, but it's got a nice almost floral top note, I should say, which is obviously coming from the sherry cask, but so it feels more like a refill sherry matured whiskey. There's a touch of coffee, there's some youthful sort of briny sort of, not, I wouldn't say off the still notes, but you can obviously get the youthful element in the blend. But hey, it's lovely, it is really nice. See what the palate's like. It's a pleasant palate. It's maybe a touch subdued, but again, the PX a little more dominant, but again, we're not talking sort of big whiny grapiness, we're talking sort of subtle notes of PX. There's a little bit of treacle. It's certainly got a lot more coffee notes kind of going on, and a little bit more wood spice and so on, a little bit of raisinated fruit. The peat does seem a little bit more reticent, it has to be said. It kind of comes through on the finish, but it's a bit more kind of laid back. It's a bit more meandering. Admittedly, you know, tasting it after the Uigeadail with that sort of the higher ABV, it's kind of almost emphasised the sort of the mellowness of the An Oa. And it's really interesting sort of tasting them after one another. I mean, maybe I should have tasted the An Oa first, but maybe that would have given me a slightly different perception of the An Oa. Who knows? Either way, it's still a very, very good whiskey. You can certainly feel the younger spirit just kind of nibbling at the edges of the palate. But again, I think it's really well put together. And, you know, all right, you may well dislike the sort of the whole Ardbeg marketing machine, and certainly they're probably not quite as shouty as Brookladdy were at their heyday, but they certainly make an awful lot of noise, which does have a tendency to put people off, it has to be said. But, you know, ignoring all the noise and the frippery and what have you, the juice in the glass, which is always the main thing in my opinion, is pretty good. Yeah. Right, moving on to the Ardbeg Grooves. As you can see from the colour of that, it is pretty dark, it has to be said. So one is imagining the wine notes are going to be quite prevalent. But anyway, let's have a look. Actually, no, it's more subtle on the wine, although it's quite... It is very oaky. Meow, yes. Oh, are you a peat head now, are you, little putty cat? Say hello to the viewers, putty cat. Yes. Anyway, where was I? Right, yeah, okay. Back to the grooves. I mean, it's obviously winey. There was a lot of sort of dried red fruits. Again, subtler peat, but it's got a sort of a more manure-y sort of character, it has to be said. And I'm guessing that is the sort of the interaction between the peat and the wine casks, which often tends to sort of make peat a little bit weird and wonderful, it has to be said. I don't think this is too weird and wonderful. I mean, it's got a touch of caramel, a touch of toffee. I mean, there is a lot of oak going on here, which is kind of, again, sort of taking the edge off the sort of like the briny sort of intensity and the peat intensity. But you know what, it is not a bad nose. I mean, I don't know what this was retailing for, you shouldn't have stood on there, should you, put a cap? There goes my pen. What do they say about not working with babies and animals? Yes. Anyway, so yeah, it's okay. Is the honest answer. Let's see what the palate's like. Really chewy, malty, tarry, treacly. I mean, if I didn't know better, I would have said this was PX matured. Doesn't have the grapiness and doesn't have the sweetness, but it's got a lot of treacle, a lot of tar. There's some edgy red wine notes. There's a lot of charred oak. Obviously, you would expect that from recharred casks. And the oak is a little bitter. But I think that bitterness kind of adds another kind of dimension. I mean, I've read reviews saying that this is a really mellow whiskey. It might be to start off with, but it certainly doesn't feel mellow on the finish, it has to be said. The bitterness of the oak really kind of grabs you by the ghoulies, as they say. Technical term there. Lovely peatiness. The peat does take a while to kind of come through. Like I said, the sort of the cask and the oak is really quite dominant kicking off, and the peat really sort of has to sort of force its way through on the finish. But the finish is really good, it has to be said. I can kind of live with that one. Right, okay, so let's move on to the committee release bottling. Let's see what the notes give us on this end, shall we? Ramped up the oak notes, it has to be said. I mean, this really does smell like treacly PX or maybe treacly Oloroso. This is the thing with... confusing thing with wine finishes, they do have a tendency to give you lots of dried fruit and that kind of character, and you initially start to go down the sort of the PX, the heavy Oloroso kind of spectrum, and when you're tasting blind, that's where you get led, and you can just get led down these kind of blind alleys. And I mean, I certainly remember when I tasted this blind, I could have sworn this was sherry, not wine. But there's a nice chocolatiness. It's got possibly a little bit more intensity. That extra alcohol is just making the nose a little fresher, and just cutting through some of that sort of like that wood. Yes, it's quite charred, and there is a quite a bit of burnt wood. But there's also a fresh, almost citric note as well. And I would say of the two, this has probably got the slightly more interesting nose. But like I said, you'd have had to been sat at your computer 2 minutes to midnight to be able to get hold of a bottle of this. But anyway, yeah, I like that. Let's see what the pile's like. Now, perversely, that feels fuller in the mouth than the 46% bottling. Quite peppery, there's a touch of paprika, a lot of wood spice, a lot of charred oak, less peat. The peat is kind of a lot, I'm not getting the intensity of peat per se that I got with the 46% bottling. It's kind of more pushed to the edges, and it, because it's mingling in with that sort of charred oak kind of character, it's almost sort of negating that kind of peat character. I mean, yes, you can still taste peat, obviously, but it doesn't have the intensity. And this is a really interesting tasting, because I mean, although I tasted all of these when I did the round one of the 2019 World Whiskey Awards, I didn't taste them all in one go, you know, straight like that. Obviously, I did the sort of probably the 10-year-olds first, and then more than no age statements or what have you. So you're obviously tasting a group of different whiskies, rather than tasting the whole, you know, what you later find out to be from one distillery. So I certainly didn't taste these back to back, and like I said, it certainly has quite a sort of a sherried kind of character. But that's obviously the impression given by the wine and the sort of the deep char, and yeah, you know, there's more salt on the finish as well. I think out of the two, I think I prefer the higher ABV version. It's just got that little bit more intensity, and certainly not quite so sort of, the oak is not quite so obvious. Well, it's still obvious, but it's not as obvious as it is at 46% when you sort of, you know, because the alcohol, I think, at the end of the day, is just kind of pushing up the peat and the spice and things like that. So, I like that. Right, okay, so let's finish with a bit of old Ardbeg. It's been a number of years since I've had an old Ardbeg, and, you know, let's see what the nose gives a scent, shall we? Oh, that is lovely. That is majestic. That is mellow. That is quite violety. It's not the more Palmer violets, but the sort of more natural violet kind of character. Gentle peat, slightly oily, a little bit dusty. Quite oily in actual fact. It's got a real fish oil kind of character. It's got a beautiful mellowness. None of your shouty oak going on here, or your the peat is particularly shouty with Ardbeg, but it's just stunning. I mean, £600. I mean, maybe if you could have, I don't know what it was when it was released, but I mean, it wasn't £600. But oh dear God, that is incredible. That is a stunning nose. Lightly herbal. It's got that sort of old Oloroso kind of herbal notes kind of coming through. Not quite so much of the American oak I'm picking up. Again, I'm guessing probably sort of well refilled American oak casks, because the emphasis is certainly more on the sort of old sherry casks. Although it does have a little bit of dusty American oak kind of coming through, just sort of the edge. And a masterful blend, should we say. Maybe if it was me, I would have obviously had more of the American oak, and I would have had more dusty, sort of sawdusty vanilla character. But stunning, absolutely stunning. I mean, yeah, that is absolutely beautifully poised and balanced. It's dusty peat, it's not sort of, you know, tarry or manurey. I mean, that is wonderfully mature. That is just classic old Islay. I'm even getting a little bit of sort of almost kind of orange conserve, sort of slightly marmalade-y kind of notes, which I've picked up in the past on older bottling of Ardbeg. Not that I've had the opportunity to taste that many older bottlings of Ardbeg, it has to be said, but... stunning. Absolutely stunning. Anyway, let's see what the palate's like. A lot more American oak on the palate, in actual fact. Milky, slightly creamy, vanilla, gentle peat, dusty, earthy notes kind of coming through. Very, very mellow. I mean, I think the problem with how why this lost out to the Bunnahabhain 25-year-old is that there's a not so much power on the palate. It's more graceful. It's elegant, and I think the trouble is going up against the 25-year-old Bunnahabhain. With the intensity of sherry character, is probably why it lost out to the overall voting. To me, this is just absolutely sublime. It is just wonderfully long. There's a lovely sort of thread of salt going through it, rock salt, touch of iodine, a little bit of tarred rope, chewy, but not overly malty. I mean, that is just a wonderful mouthful. It's really balanced, it's really long, and it's stunningly impressive, it has to be said. It's not shouting at you, it is really laid back, really mellow, So let's sum today's episode of the show up. Certainly, Barbie's a fan of Ardbeg. I love Ardbeg. I'm not sort of, as you probably well know, I'm not fixated on any one particular distillery. So it's not like I'm a kind of dyed-in-the-wool Ardbegian, or as they say. But I do love the distillery, and I think the 10-year-old, really is, bang for your buck. Really, really good if you love peated whiskies. It's like I said. I said earlier, it's probably the best improved 10-year-old whiskey that I can certainly think of, and it's just got everything you want from an Islay, and not huge mountains of peat. It's got sort of like enough peat to be of owl interest. It's got sharp claws. The Corryvreckan, like I said, when tasting, it is not the same as it used to be, and I'm definitely 100% certain that there is now some sherry cask matured spirit being used in this, which to me kind of removes from that intensity. I mean, I remember sort of tasting things like the almost there and the still there and the sort of almost practically just about getting there kind of bottlings that they did, which had that wonderful intensity, and it's lost a little bit of that intensity along the way. So that's my only kind of criticism with that one. The Uigeadail, I can understand why people love that. I mean, a lot of people love their big sherry, and there is certainly on the palate a lot more of the Oloroso sherry kind of character, and it works. I still think it's pretty well balanced overall, and if I'm in the mood for a bit of peat and sherry, then certainly you can't go too far wrong with the Uigeadail. The An Oa, it's a bit different. I mean, it's not quite what I was expecting from something that has PX sherry casks being used in the vatting. Obviously, like I said, I think the percentage of PX casks used is relatively low, because the PX certainly doesn't dominate it. And maybe on the palate it does a little bit more so, and maybe it is a bit more mellow and a bit more laid back. And if you like or prefer the intensity of the things like the Uigeadail, then you might find it a little bit lacking. But I think certainly as a standalone whisky, it's not too bad at all. The Grooves, yeah, I mean, interesting. I mean, sort of packaging and frippery and all that kind of gubbins aside, it's not a bad whisky. But I think of the two, I think the committee release with that higher ABV just shades it for me. It's got that little bit more intensity and just that little bit more interest. But obviously, like I said, you know, you had to be sat up to get hold of it. Otherwise, well, I mean, if you are sat up at 5 to bloody midnight, it still just disappears, you know. It all goes off to Germany and Scandinavia and wherever, I imagine. Anyway. And the 20-something, obviously the standout bottling of the tasting. Yes, bloody expensive now if you want to get your hands on one. But, you know, it just shows you how beautiful old Ardbeg actually is. And, you know, it is one of life's kind of lovely moments to be able to get to taste old Ardbeg, you know. I mean, I certainly couldn't afford to sort of buy a bottle of that, so the only time I'm ever likely to sort of come across it is if I'm doing some judging, and I know that that puts me in quite a sort of a privileged position. And, you know, I'll always be thankful to the Whiskey Magazine Paragraph Publishing for making me part of the whole process, should we say, or at least offering me the opportunity. So anyway, diverging from the whiskey a little bit, the stunning, absolutely stunning, it has to be said. So, you know, rounding up, I mean, this has been a really interesting episode for me to taste all of these in kind of one go, because I don't get the opportunity to do so very often, and hopefully it's been interesting for you guys, because this is what I like to do. I like to offer an insight into a distillery. There's no point, in my personal opinion, doing maybe just one or two bottlings, because yes, you can review that, and it doesn't really give you much of an insight into the distillery when you can do sort of their whole range. And, you know, I guess not too many people have the opportunity or the deep pockets to be able to do such a thing. It really does kind of give you a kind of a real insight into the distillery and what they're trying to do, and it's as much a learning, an interesting learning kind of curve, as I guess hopefully it is for you guys. So anyway, that's this week's episode of the show in the bag. There should be another one at the weekend, although I haven't quite figured out what I'm going to do. I've got some stuff down there, it has to be said, so it will probably be something of that, or then again, I may well just go rummaging in some boxes. Anyway, until the weekend, I hope you enjoy the rest of the week, and good dramming, and good afternoon.